As I said, my title for here the last presentation is Biomimetics for Disruptive Conceptualization Industry. And I hope I can live up to that title. Biomimetic technology. As I write here, disruptive conceptualization can be based on new technology, as I've mentioned a couple of times earlier. And this new technology can then solve functional problems. That's where it's become interesting in industry for making disruptive innovation. Nature has a comprehensive collection of technological solutions. I mean, it have billions of years to develop these solutions to functional problems and has proven that it works. We have seen quite a lot of examples so far, and you will see some more here now in the coming minutes. I have some examples here of functional problems that can be solved by nature. It could be how to attach, how to handle stuff, how to minimize or maximize friction, how to resist deterioration, how to optimize energy, how to self-repair, how to make selective attraction and injection, and there are others. I've selected here in the coming a number of examples where I will both display how the biology has found a solution and then how it is applied in reality. How have you made the transfer into technology? The first example is similar to what we just heard about with the spider attachment to surfaces. The gecko attachment has been studied many places, also in Germany. I think there's a group in Kiel that works on this with Stanislav Gorb. This is from Wikipedia, but this is just a gecko. It's quite fascinating that these creatures, they can climb up a glass wall, which is completely flat. And that can be mimicked. This is a picture that I got taken over at Stanford University, where Mark Kutkowski and his group, they work in mimicking, they make robots, and they want also these robots to be able to climb a wall. And this little robot that I'm holding, the feet on this robot is casted by the students, the master students in his group. And I tell that because, just to illustrate, that it's actually not that difficult. It's at least manageable to make a replica of the gecko feet in order to get enough strength to climb a glass window which this robot is hanging at. They also made some bigger replicas which were used by mountain climbers, and they showed that these mountain climbers, they could climb a five-story wall using only these facilities, and that was pretty good. I mean, they also had a rope just in case that they were falling down, but it worked. Now, this same type of attachment mechanism, it's nice because the gecko can attach and deattach, just like you explained with the spider, that there's where the spider had this little triangle, then the gecko does it that way, that it puts its feet down just like a piece of tape, and then it peels off. It starts by lifting its fingers off again. So it's similar principles as the triangles in the spider foot. The nice thing is that it is a detachable glue. You can put it on and off and on and off and continue doing that. And therefore, it's an interesting application for industry where you need glue that will stick to many different things but doesn't leave sticky glue onto the surface. And that has been utilized in Austria by this company, which call themselves Gecko. And what they do is that they make it that you can put different skins on your skis for different properties, so you will ski in different ways. And it looks this way, that the red stuff is the gecko tape, which then will attach to the bottom side of the ski and be able to be taken off again, and then you will just have the raw ski, which also will be able to take a tour down the slope. So that's nature used in an industrial product. Robots, we all know robots, and one could ask the question, why do they always look like this? Why do they always have these stiff pins and rotary hinges? And you always need to have a rope around them because you get you really get hurt if you get close to them because they don't know you're there, so they will just move close to you. Of course, you could say that this is bio-inspired because it looks somewhat like our arm, that you have stiff sections which are combined in links. So maybe it is bio-inspired, but it could be inspired by something else, and that is what is done by Festo. They have made this elephant trunk-inspired robot, where it's pneumatic, and it's simply by having a number of pneumatic areas which can inflate and deflate, and that way it can be quite maneuverable. Besides, it also has a gripper with three grippers, which works so it can pick up very delicate parts. I saw a demonstration of it where it was picking up eggs, raw eggs, without hurting it. So this is a different approach, a different structure for making a robot, and it has the nice options that it is more safe, and it has the possibility to handle delicate parts. So it can, the robot will be able to operate without safety equipment around it, because if it hits you, it will simply bend off. It is not that strong. Then, many of you probably know the Fast Skin by Speedo. It was the Olympics back in Beijing. A lot of the swimmers used this swimsuit and was later banned because it gave you too much of a competitive advantage. It was simply too effective. And that was, I guess, not the idea of the sport, to give you an advantage. But it works. It is inspired by the shark. The shark has produces micro turbulences close to the skin, which will reduce the drag, and therefore you will actually experience that you can speed up a bit if you put on one of those skins. And this is certainly sold by this company. I talked a lot about this phenomenon with one of our retired professors here from fluid dynamics, Paul Scheel, because he's a very modest man. I read a National Geographic history of these penguins. It's fascinating that when they dive, whenever a sea lion or another predator comes after it, it is able to speed up by a factor 3. That's quite a lot underwater. And it is thanks to small air bubbles which it releases from under its feathers. When it dives out from the ice, it will lie in the top surface of the water and pick up air under the feathers, and then it will dive down. And whenever it needs to release, it just lifts the feathers a little bit and then releases the bubbles, and then it can make this speed top up. And I discussed this a lot with Paul Scheel, and he says, well, yeah, it is really. He has made all the calculations on it and helped these people. And that was what was written about in National Geographic. But he says, my immediate idea was to use it somewhere else. Like what? What do you think it could be used for? Well, it's quite obvious.
Submarines,
yeah, or ordinary ships. And I proposed and discussed that with him, and he says, yeah. He could see the idea, but the problem is that you get instability because you get a lower friction towards the water. But that also means that it's difficult to control the direction of the ship and the stability in the water, and maybe also the propulsion from the screw in the back of the ship. But Mitsubishi, they didn't listen to Paul Scheel, so they made it anyway. So Mitsubishi in Japan has made a system for ships which releases air bubbles and thereby increases the energy efficiency of the ships. The other biomimetic school in Germany, in Bremen, have done a lot of work on also on sharks, and I'm not quite sure whether this high fish hout arises from the same, from this department. Are you aware of that? It does. Yeah, but the nice thing is that apart from the shark skin has lower friction in water, it also has a nice property. When you look at sharks, then nothing growing on them. I mean, you try, if you have a ship, you will know that you could, whatever you put into water, the seaweed and the barnacles, they will very quickly start to grow on it. They do not do that on sharks, and also to only to a limited extent on dolphins. And the reason is that the microstructure on the scales prohibit them in getting attachment. So it's a physical mechanism. It's not poison, because normally when you want ships not to be fouled to get growth on them, then you put a lot of poisonous chemicals on the ship, and then therefore you need to do that regularly because the poison is used. But here, as this picture shows, you can actually treat it with the physical structure of small mechanisms, which will prevent the stuff from being attached to. And that's a nice industrial product. Talking about energy efficiency, you probably all noticed when you're out flying that most modern airplanes have these small wing tips. And that is also directly inspired by birds. When you see birds, you will also see that they do exactly the same thing when they fly. So you will get, actually you reduce the turbulences out at the tip of the wing by simply making this little tip. So that's another area where it's being applied. This guy up here, I talked to him a couple of years over in the United States, and for a Dane, it was very funny. He was an American, so he was called Professor Fisk. I'm sure he didn't realize what that means in Danish, fish. But he studied whales and other sea animals, and he also, one of the creatures that he studied was this humpback whale, which has a fin with a lot of bumps on it. And he found out that these bumps actually also reduces drag. And he said he was actually nominated to win the Index Award Prize here in Denmark. So shortly after that, I talked to him in San Diego. He said he was going to Copenhagen, and hopefully to pick up the prize of 2.5 million kroner, or how much it was. I don't know, I don't remember whether he won, but he said he had been talking to some of the Danish windcraft producers, and they were not interested in the invention. So he had now sold it to a Canadian windmill producer. And they have made this company called Whale Power Corporation, which then using it on windmills, but also on many other types of fans, which then become more efficient. Would you like to take a trip over this, or when you are skiing in the Alps, you may experience some of these bridges. This is a bridge reaching over this cliff, this valley. It's reaching 52 meters, and it's a balloon bridge. It's blown up. Well, it's a combination of balloon and what you call the tensarity principle, where you use wires to get a stiff structure. But the what carries the load is this. There are two big balloons, and they will be there for the whole winter. It works nice. It doesn't weigh that much. It's easy to set it up and take it down again. It's lightweight. But there's one problem, and that is it could puncture. And what happens if it punctures? Then no more bridge. So therefore, this company, or these two companies in Germany and Switzerland, I think it is, they have been looking in self-healing structures. And they got inspired, for instance, not only one thing, but one plant that I really got inspired by was the lianas, where you have very tall, very slim plant structures, which needs to carry the water up for a very long distance. If they get hurt, if there comes a hole in there, in this plant, they very quickly lose the water pressure, and therefore they need to have mechanisms which self-repair very quickly. So they started that and found a mechanism which could be put inside the balloons so they will very quickly self-repair and keep the pressure which is necessary in the balloons. Something rather different is biological pest control. This is a project, it's actually a bachelor project that I had together with the Copenhagen University and a UK company looking on pest controls. And it's a small trap that you set out in strawberry and raspberry fields. The nice thing is that it it catches all the insects that you're not interested in. Normally what you would do is that you would spray with a pesticide. The problem is that this pesticide is not specific to a certain insect. It will kill all the insects, or most of the insects in the area. Now, once you've done that, after a couple of days, some insects find out, then the pesticide is washed away, and some other insects find out, here, there's no other competition here, so they will dominantly come in and take over the area. So you will, once you have sprayed with a pesticide, you will experience an invasion of something else in a short while, shortly after. So it's nice if you can keep a balance of the fauna in the area. Don't take it away at all, but only take whatever is not what you don't like to have there, and that is the ones that will kill, which will destroy your barriers. So therefore, both in organic farming and in traditional farming, they're very interested in these traps, provided that they are manageable. And that's where design and innovation students here from DTU could make a difference, because they would know how to ask the farmers, what do you need, figure out how many, how easy should it be to pick, set up all these traps, maybe if they need some they need some pheromones to attract the insects, that should be easy to refill them. But they came up with a proposal which were manageable in big big fields with strawberries, and could also be used where in the right side you can see that they are grown at higher heights, so you can pick the berries while standing. But they were useful both places. Another biological pest control example I have from a professor at Penn State, Aklaj Laktagia. He's actually a professor in photonics and physics, and he worked together with a couple of biologists, because they had the problem in the United States, just like we have the elm disease, they have the ash diseases, which I don't know if it kills the ash tree, but they make them ugly looking. And that is, the reason is also in this case, just like in the elm tree, it's a small creature here, a small beetle, the ash borer, which places eggs in the ash tree, and then the larvae would go in and make damage to the tree. So again, you want to make targeted killing of these animals. So what you do, you find out what is the biological mechanism. These ash borers, when they mate, when a male seeks a female, he would, just like the morpho butterfly, look for the other sex. And if that, and here it's actually structurally colored, like Vilas you talked about. So if the male sees the right type of structural color reflecting the angle dependency, giving the right reflections, then he will rush on to this, which he think is a female. Now, this is not a female when Aklaj and his biologist friends has had on it. It's a replica where they have made the same type of structural color, but they also made it to an electrical chair. They made to put 10,000 volt on it. So whenever this male tries to mate with this supposedly female, he would not survive. So that's one way of handling biological pest control with biological inspiration. You could also seek inspiration in termites. Termite mounds are fantastic because they can keep an indoor climate where you control the amount of oxygen and the amount of carbon dioxide and the temperature. They can both get rid of excess heat, and they can produce heat at the bottom. At the bottom of the mound, they have a fungus which they live together with, which can produce heat when it gets too cold. And then they can open and close for ventilation. So it's only natural ventilation which gives a nice indoor climate. So that has given much inspiration to different people. This is quite a famous example from Zimbabwe, which has a shopping center which uses natural ventilation. And it was engineered by a UK company, Arup, which... It works quite simple, that you have air channels under the roof. The air will be heated, and therefore you will make a draft upwards, which then will carry the air up through the building. then you will ask, why don't they just make ordinary air condition? And the reason was that you all know that the dictator of Zimbabwe is called Mugabe, and he's not very well liked. And another thing is that Zimbabwe do not have many natural resources, so therefore they have to buy oil. So therefore they are very interested in resources that doesn't, in solution that doesn't use oil, which can be based on natural resources. So that was driving this. But it's a very nice example of natural ventilation inspired by the termites. Actually, in Denmark, we have another much smaller company which has been producing this type of natural ventilation for many years. So again, that you heat up at the top of the house, get natural ventilation through the house, and then they have some sort of intelligent control of the air coming in under the windows, so you only get the amount of fresh air you need, not too much, so you don't get a draft. So there are companies that really think of this, and it's strange that it's not more widespread, because I mean you save a lot of energy this way. Then I have an example of that's also actually originating from Germany. Quite a lot of the examples, you Germans must be quite clever in thinking of these things. This is a professor from Stuttgart, I think. It's from Freiburg, yeah. Yeah. But this bird of paradise flower unfolds, but there are no hinges. It's a sort of bending mechanism, which is explained here by having a piece of wood with a piece of paper on it. And when you bend the piece of wood, the piece of paper would bend in the one direction. Quite simple. But that's the way that it worked in the plant. And that has been used by architects. One of the places is here in a pavilion in the Expo 2012 in Korea. And all of these blinds, they are... they do not have hinges that which can rotate them. There you simply just bend them, push them a little bit, and then they will open up in the middle. So, and that idea comes from this flower. And then, as my last example, I have a thing that I work with myself, and that is needles made from polymer. Because there's a lot of inspirations to be gained in nature. Making medical needles from polymer has the big challenge that polymers are very soft, so they will not be able to penetrate the skin. So the immediate judgment for polymer needles would be that they will not be able to replace steel. But at the end, again, you could ask, what does nature do? We all know that mosquitoes, they can penetrate skin. They have a polymer needle. It's made of chitin, which is organized in structures which remind very much about ordinary polymer materials. And it's only, some of them are only about 40 microns, which is maybe one-fourth or one-sixth of the thinnest metal needles you use. And it succeeds in penetrating our skin. So how does it do it? It works that way that there's a lot of mechanisms. I'm not going to tire you with them, but one of the mechanisms that is fairly easy to mimic is to do what it does here, that you have a supporting mechanism which supports the needle, so simply make it thicker part of the area, and therefore prevent it in bending to the sides. So that's one way of making the polymer needles realistic. There are a number of other things that it needs to do in order to be able to penetrate the skin, and that's what we are looking at the moment, making it realistic. Then I just took a few examples of where can you find more information about all of this, because there are a number of places, a number of organizations which work with biomimicry, biomimetics, bionic, what you call it, many things, in order to make this trend, to carry on the information from biologists onto other people, industry and other people that likes to use the information. And one of them is the Biomimicry Institute in Montana, in the United States. They have this website, and they do consultancy work within this area. And they also have made a very neat website called asknature.org, which at least can give you some examples of what you can find out in nature. Another organization is a private organization called Swedish Biomimetic 3000. They find innovations inspired by nature and take them into the marketplace. And one of the innovations that they really have been using a lot of efforts on is this little beetle called the bombardier beetle. It has been studied very much by a professor in Leeds, Professor McIntosh. And the interesting thing is that when you irritate this little beetle, it will mix a cocktail of poisonous acid, I think. At least it's acid, and it's also boiling. And it's sprayed onto whatever is approaching it. Now, of course, it's not so much the substances that is mimicked. It's the way that it sprays, makes the spray, and therefore it opens up for all sorts of industries which are interested in making sprays or aerosols. There's good inspiration in how such a little creature functions. And finally, going back to Germany, as I said, Germany has produced many good examples, German researchers, as you also have experienced here today. And there's a German organization called Biocon, which both have researchers and industry as a member. A couple of years ago, I went to their convention in Berlin, which had about 300 delegates, half industry, half coming from university. And they also promote the knowledge exchange between the two parties. So this is what I have prepared for you today. As I said, I would not use the full hour. The idea was that we could have a short plenum discussion here about the topics of today, and then we can go out and have a little drink, maybe continue the talks among the people that would like to stay a little while. But first, let me hear any viewpoints on this topic here with biomimetics and disruptive innovation? All right. I'm sorry. Well, thank you very much for the applause. Yeah, Tobias.
I have a couple of, let's say, problems that identify. As usually when companies come to us, they have two desires. One, can you make it a bit better? Mm. And a bit better is not very disruptive. And usually we're not in the best position to optimize an existing product by 10%. And the next question they have is, we have this massive problem we couldn't solve in 12 years, but could you make it till next week? A bit. Which of course disruptive, as we said prior, takes time and it takes a lot of years, especially when you want to have a big step from a biological product, you have to spend a couple of years in it, and companies don't see that point. So that where I see a problem for the actual progress, let's say. So either it's not very disruptive, or it's just from companies not appreciated that it actually takes time.
What is the people here from industry, what is your feeling, is time, is that, would that be a problem limiting the application of biological inspiration in when you have to rethink your products? Try to think of, I mean, if you want to go into a new technology, use a new material, you also use time.
Exactly. If you want to go into something, no matter if it is inspired by biology or anything else, if it's really something new, you also set off the time to do it. You wouldn't try to make a quick fix out of that. So I don't think it's a problem.
So if it's the right solution, then one would use the time. Is that what you say?
It would definitely be something long term.
Yeah.
Because if we really want to go into something where we see a potential, we would take the time for it. We wouldn't look for a quick fix.
No. Lasse, you had some interesting viewpoints on disruption when we were talking in the break.
Yeah.
So maybe you could share them with us.
I just thought it was kind of funny to hear that it seems like there are very different perceptions of what disruption is. And the way I see it, it's if you have something that's disruptive, it, as you said, creates a new market. But it also makes the existing technologies or systems redundant. And that's why I think that there's a lot of these things that we've talked about today. Maybe more is on the verge of being radical innovation, or maybe incremental innovation, and not maybe necessarily disruptive. But as we also talked about, it depends on, are you seeing it from the industry's side of view or point of view, or are you seeing from the users? Is it a medtech industry? Is it a Samsung or Apple launching telephones every 6 months? So I think there's a lot of ways of viewing it. And also thing, as we talked about, it's one thing is also that a lot of these established company has been doing the same thing for many years, and a lot of these very disruptive, innovative companies are in a market that's very, we call it, exponentially growing. I think that's also a factor that it makes some of these companies very disruptive with regards to creating a new market and making the existing market or existing product redundant. But I definitely think that if there's a possibility, and if there's something that makes sense to pursue inside of biomimetics, I think that makes sense, definitely.
Right. So have any of you yourself any examples of how either new technology or nature-inspired technology has made a difference in your history in the companies that you come from? And you have examples of where it has made a difference, not necessarily from nature, but where I was thinking about, it could be interesting, we heard of a number of histories here today about how has change been with a new product. So you also think about maybe some of you have earlier stories from where you've seen inspiration from another material or another technology, which was the reason for making this leap, whether you then call it disruptive or radical. Anyone having any examples of this?
Speaking about the shark.
Yeah.
Suit. I think it's also the same kind of concept is also used on golf balls, I think, creating micro turbulence in the small dimples of golf balls. And I know that there's a company trying to put this on trucks in order to minimize the drag and raise the efficiency.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good story. DTU being thrown around.
Yeah. All right. Usually you would extract insulin from animals, and now it's made by yeast.
Yeah.
Which has been genetically altered. So that's definitely, I don't know, it's the same product, but it's a disruptive method.
Yeah. Especially because you can gene manipulate the yeasts, so you can.
But you wouldn't necessarily think of yeast producing insulin. That would be cows or dogs. Or
exactly.
Pigs.
Yeah, that's a good example also. Yeah.
And increasingly, it could be a challenge to Novo Nordisk if you, by applying technology and data management, so big data. If you could treat diabetes in the same way as the modern insulins that we're making, that would be a threat.
Yeah.
If you could do that with biosimilars, so very cheap insulins.
Yeah.
Together with technology and data management.
Yeah. I guess the pharmaceutical business is probably has been bio-inspired almost ever since it started. Because, I mean, the whole, when we talk about preserving the rainforest and the different natural environments around the Earth, one of the arguments is that think about all the fantastic medicine which may be lost if we cut down all these trees and remove these animals. So, I mean, there is a lot of inspiration to gathered there. When I started to get interested in biomimetics myself, it was, I mean, from a completely different viewpoint, because I'm a mechanical engineer. So, and that was new, that or newer, that that you actually also there could be inspired by nature.
So, just one question that it seems to be somewhere, being an academic person, that the industry seems to have a problem of finding a good disruptive concepts from biomimics. And you are interested in the biology, but you find it hard to convince the industry that there is a solutions. And maybe it's not really the case of all the researchers to go and find the really concepts that prove out to be disruptive innovations, but rather to research on that matter. So is there some kind of need for a medium or is there already a medium for documenting and collecting the potential from the biology?
Yeah. Yeah, that's there was actually a similar question to what I asked Tobias about what you do in Germany. I guess the Ask Nature website is one example where you can. It works like a sort of a wiki application where you can upload your ideas about nature, and then hopefully someone would see it. But I don't know. It may be one way of doing it. I actually don't know what the right way would be to make this knowledge transfer, to make that accessible over a broader range. There might be many different ways of doing it, but I don't know what the right way would be. But I do think that there is a need. I mean, when you see all the good stories that are out there just waiting for someone to see, oh, this really fits my problem, then yeah, there's a need. All right. Any more viewpoints on the two topics here of today? Yeah?
I'm just sitting and thinking, because when you do mechanical development, you do these conceptualization phases and idea generations. And it might be nice if you could sort of group biomimetics into attachment ideas. What kind of attachments solutions do we see in nature, and what kind of coloring solutions, and something like a database in that sense that you could use in an idea generation.
Yes,
I think would be exciting. Sort of like the design site you've made. I remember.
Oh, yeah.
It's a long time ago, but it was a nice idea, and something in the biomimetics.
Yeah, yeah. I think that would be a brilliant idea if one could do that. I think the Ask Nature database does it a little bit,
okay, yeah.
But it requires that you actually then use the effort of going into that also as a researcher. But I mean, Eric is an example of you. I find you quite atypical of many biologists, because you come here and present a functional problem, night vision. I mean, many biologists would say, no, I study elephants or the organism. And therefore, the link from the organism over to the functional problem is much longer. I mean, you found Toyota. You found the industry because it was more apparent what you are working with and that what the relevance was for industry. But I think that would be the problem in many other cases. So when I've been working together with biologists, that is often the problem of this they think of me as a reductionist, that I try to cut things down to a minimum sense. Well, you cannot do that, Torben. I mean, you're only interested in the application or something very specific around this creature or this plant. But, I mean, there's so much more to it. It's much more fantastic, and we need to describe much more about it. But, yeah, so there's a cultural difference that we need to come over.
That's actually really true, because that's also probably the reason why Toyota found Eric.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Tobias?
I have to write a bit. It's not only a cultural thing. If you research on animals, you often have the problem of putting that what you're finding into perspective. What does it actually mean? What's the context of it? And this you can do the more you know about the animal. If you research for 20 years on one specific organism, you can tell what the result means way easier than if you just start on one function. So this organism-centered approach is very important, but as you said, then if you go towards a certain functionality, towards a certain product, as a biologist, you have to switch that all off and just use it for that task, which is kind of the exercise. What I see is important. And the other part that I see is important on how to be found, like it was found, night vision by a big company. So they have probably, as you said, a whole group of people that constantly kind of have their fingers everywhere and read each kind of documents and probably even automated algorithms that do it for them. But Toyota is quite a big player. So how do you get found by a medium enterprise? And it doesn't have to be a 10-person group, but like 100, 400-person company that has a specific problem. How do you find the right people? And the database kind of works, but kind of also doesn't work, as the people don't know what to look for and who to call up. So that's, I think, a big problem, how to get the matching done. Yes, I think that's one of the things we have to think better about and to get it more out.
Right.